Today we are going to talk about Cinema 4D and X-Particles. And X-Particles is a plugin for Cinema 4D to create advanced particle simulations. And you will see that you can do a lot of things with that. So first of all, my name is Mario Chanfuk. I'm a staff member of Insidium. And I joined Insidium 2 years ago. And before that, I was working as an art director for Pixelmondo 7 years. And I know the struggles of a motion designer for deadlines. And I try to bring that knowledge into Cinema 4D and into Insidium to improve the product as well. And it's a lot of fun. So today, I would like to show you some nice workflows that I'm possibly helping you with your new X-Particle workflow, creating X-Particle styles. And first, I want to show you how to create detail and complexity with particles. Then a quick guide into data mapping. It's something you definitely want to know that. And reactive design in the end. And first of all, I would like to show you how I got into this business. And here you see a graph where I started with another 3D software. It was not that usable as Cinema 4D. And then I started getting more and more into Cinema 4D. And later, 3 years ago, I started X-Particles. And lately, Cycles 4D, and which is a great addition to rendering particles. And my former clients were mainly automobile clients. So if you do stuff a lot of the same clients and of the same type, you start to get a little bit bored. And the motivation goes down. And yeah, you try to find yourself and new things. And there was a point in my life where I thought about what to do. And then I started I found X-Particles and Cinema 4D in combination. And I got motivation back and start daily designs. And this is now how I got started with X-Particles. It's when you started in motion design and After Effects, you know probably Trapcode Particular. And it's a particle system in 2D that's pretty fast, but it's not real 3D. And X-Particles brings real three-dimensional particles, and you have collision, you have wind, you have all the nice features that I weren't able to do before. And here you can you see particles along a spline, and then you have more splines, and you can. I figured out how to group particles, and then how to render particles in Cinema 4D, and yeah, it's amazing. And a particle cannot only be a point in 3D space, it can be everything. You can render particles as instances. Oh, it's a little bit slow working here. All right. So here you see an example of a wind effector driving particles up and down, and they are creating this very nice carbon fiber. And this was my first artwork done with X-Particles. Then here you see some later in the version 3.5 that we have some fluid simulation algorithms then that you can create from particles. You can create other objects. Here's the simulation. And also you can do abstract things. And it works very well with the MoGraph module as well. It's perfect, integrated. And we can paint particles that are getting into objects. Then, yeah, and my favorite part, you can create very nice motion design with X particles. All right, detail and complexity. Here you see some artworks I did. For the release of 3.5, and they all have one thing in common. They're using a certain type of emission. And here you see a typical particle emitter. And there are different types of emission, and this is really basic. It starts pretty basic. Here you have point emission, one single particle. Then you have edge emission, then the area and volume, and we are going to talk about the edge and the area emission. And if you have an area and a force of particles, you see they are quite scattered, and there's a little bit of space in between the particles, and it looks a little bit low res. And the difference, when you use edge emission, in contrary, you see that you get a lot of more details in the turbulences, the forces, you actually make the algorithms visible. This is awesome, and I can show you that in Cinema 4D quickly. So here I have a simple emitter for mixed particles running with the wind modifier. And then I can go into the menu over here and use a domain, XP domain, and this is like volume fluid container simulating our particles in 3D space like a fluid. And I can reduce the size a little bit. And you see that it's now going a little bit down over here. And now I change the algorithm to use gaseous particles. Then I reduce the settings a little bit to have it played in real time. All right. That's coming slowly. And increase the volume a bit. And now the particles are getting attracted by the forces. And you see the area emission is quite scattered over here. And when I change this into object emission, and I can insert my rectangle, which is a spline, and it's set to edges, and then you can see that our forces are drawing the particle shapes. They're much more dense, much more beautifully looking. It's amazing. You can see over here, it's like drawn very, very dense. And here you can see some examples how this looks. Here it's the same technique using flat emitters. And you see that the vortex, the forces are pushing the particles together. And here you see an example rendered with Cycles 4D, where the colors are driven by the velocity. And this is what you get with thin particle emission, and it's an awesome tool. All right. The next type of emission I would like to show you is the object emission. So you can use 3D objects and emit particles from that. And you can use character animation or simple shapes. And there is different kinds of modes for this as well. So you have, for example, the mesh edges. And here you say, when you use the edges here, you have like this grid. And it's working actually quite well. And this is pretty useful for user interface stuff. And let's go quickly into Cinema 4D and how to set up that. Let's open the mesh over here. So here I have a simple cube. It's a sphere. And emitter on the right side, and a little bit of wind affecting this. And now I want to use this as my object, so I go to X Particles Emitter, change this to Object, and I can just drag and drop my object into the Object tab over here, and then I just change this to Edges, and now you can see that it's emitting from the mesh. I want to have now a shot emission, so it's generating the particles only at the first frames. And I want to have a little bit more particles. All right, and now it's getting a little bit more like into the Tron theme. And I want to have even more. And you can see that the turbulence are creating a really, really nice look over here. And in X Particles, you have also the very nice possibility to change the colors of your particles depending on certain parameters. And here you have the parameter, for example, I use the parameter speed. And let's change the particles when they start with a low speed, they are blue. And then they should get a little bit more hot the faster they are. All right, and then let's go into the very bright colors. And then here you have this very nice auto switch that it automatically normalizes the colors. And then you see what is going to happen over here. This is pretty nice. So this technique has limits. So if you want to have more details, you have to make the object more dense, so the mesh more segments. And that can be really slow. And to solve that, there is one more technique you can use. And that is actually the texture brightness. And you can emit from a texture, any texture. And this is an Escher grid. And here you see, when you use this, you have a lot of more details coming from the mesh. And it's not a mesh, it's a texture, but it's working like a mesh through the thin emission. So to set this up, I quickly choose a Cinema 4D texture. For example, oh yeah, I have it over here. And then my mesh. All right, it's applied to the sphere, and I can just go into my X-particle scene, X-particles emitter, change this to texture, and you can drag and drop your texture into the texture tag. And here you have set, it's already set the color to emit the channel and the color channel. And now let's see what happens. You see that the grid, you can see the representation of the grid over here. And when you now increase the particle amount, it's getting more dense, and you start to see very nice details. This could be actually a planet made of a city planet or something like this. And it's looking amazing. This is not possible in 2D. This is already 3D. And this is how it looks with the particles render. And yeah, I hope that this is pretty useful for any kind. And then the next step would be using color emission. And this color emission is really useful for creating like particle displacement. Here you see I've used another image to create this very nice details on the sand surface. Or here I used the JS placement texture to emit trails from that. And here I just used this lava picture to project the colors for my particles over here. And to set that up in Cinema 4D, you can just let's open a scene over here. All right. All right, this is our basic mesh emission. And then just what we did before, let's open here and change texture. Then drag the, it's already there. Drag the texture into here. It has to be, it's not linked yet. So just link the texture. And yet now the particles are inheriting the color. And you have some options to try to do something with the particles, with the colors. So let's just use the color for the speed channel. And then you when you increase now the particle speed in the emission tab, you can see that the particles are moving depending on the color brightness. And now you can just add an X-particles trail. And you can see that you can quickly create very nice details out of your texture emission. All right. All right, so the next step would be using all those data for intelligent looking particles. And therefore, I want to show you a nice way that not many are using the data mapping. And the data mapping, what is data mapping? It's similar to question and actions, which is basically a control system in X-particles that usually you used espresso nodes or coding. And here we have a very simple system to create dependencies between particles. And to use questions and actions, I just quickly check Cinema 4D and go into my demo scene. So here we have, like we did before, this texture emission. And then in the XP emitter, you can just create a question. And this says that my particle, I want to see the colors of the particles. And when the color is brighter than this, I can create an action over here. So it checks if the particle color is higher than this white, this gray tone. And now I can just add the question. And I want to have a direct action. And here I can change the scale of the particle. And here I can set a radius, like pretty big. And now if you play, you see that I extracted information from the particle depending on the texture color. And this is pretty nice already. And now the data mapping uses all the range of all the data that is available. So, and here you see an example of the right, that the darker particles are smaller, and the brighter the particles get, the larger the radius. And the bridge between those two data ranges is called data mapping. And you find the mapping, let's kick this over here, in every modifier of X particles. So you have direct control about all of them. And let's go to the scale modifier again. And then let's quickly check how it looks a little bit scientific, but you can see how it's working. So on the left side, you have the parameter you want to change of your particle. Then on the right side, your incoming infos, like the color. And then down below, you have all, this is the whole range of the color brightness that is going to be checked. And on the y-axis is demonstrating the particle radius. So you see that the brighter the range gets, the larger the particle radius. So let's check this out in Cinema 4D. So now I go into, first I have to set the XP scale to use particle radius. And I want to set a value like this. All right, you see that now I'm able to change the radius of the particles in real time. And I will add a mapping. And now we change the radius over here to use the particle radius. And I want to map the color brightness. And when I play that, you can see that there's a lot of more detail coming in. And I can, in real time, I can change the size of the particles. And I can clamp this, can use this very intuitively. And let's quickly show that how does it look in Cycles 4D. So I will just quickly add a plane. Then I will create a nice emission. And I will go and use the black body emission over here. Let's change the layout to use my cycles layout. All right. And now I want to add this. So I'm moving the light above my scene. And you see the texture is revealed slowly. This is running on my GPU over here. And I can increase the strength, and I want to use a daylight color. And I can simply add a Cycles 4D object material and put it onto my emitter. And the light is a little bit too bright. Something like this. All right, and you see that the particles are our instances over here, and now I can just add a particle info node and put the color inside. And when I deactivate the texture, you can see that the particles are inheriting the color. And here, for example, you can change the shape of the particles pretty easily by using, for example, let's use a cube. Let's make it 10 by 10 centimeters. And when I add the cycles for the X-Particles tag, I can use different kind of objects. And here I can just drag in the cube. And you see then that Cycles4D now creates a lot of more, instead of particles, it's using cubes, and I can just easily adjust the size with the size multiplier over here. And I can increase the size, for example, to create very nice looking particle instances. And if you want to add depth of field, just add the Cycles4D camera, pick the camera depth, and increase the focal distance, and then you have very nice looking detail just out of one texture. All right, and I want to show you a little bit of all right, now we discussed data mapping. And here you see some examples you can do with that. For example, you can use it in biology, cell structures, or here is an example like more graphical use. And with the custom data, you can do reactive design. And reactive design, I want to introduce X-Particles Dynamics. And X-Particles Dynamics, this is one of my most loved features. It's the XP constraints I'm going to use. And you see some experiments I did with constraints. And it's an intelligent system, and it creates connections between the particles. For example, this is a pretty common example, doing a spider web simulation and rendering is as trails in Cinema 4D. And I want to show you how to do a constraints reaction setup. And therefore, I just go into Cinema 4D and open, let's open this file over here. I quickly change to my standard view. And here I have a rigid body object just falling on the ground. And I assigned a collider tag to it over here, an X-Particles collider. So the particles will see how the object is colliding with them. And then let's create an X-Particles emitter. And let's change the emission type to object. And let's put in the floor. And now I should be able to spawn particles from the floor. And then I just want to have a shot emission. And no initial speed. So they are created on the same spot. And then let's change it to circle. A little bit of color change over here. And you see that the particles are colliding with my collider object. And let's change the emit from area over here. So the particle more spread around, more randomly spread across the area over here. And now I want to add dynamics. And here you can add that by going to the dynamics tab, go XP constraints. And I want to connect them at the birth. And now you see that they are somehow connected. And you can display this algorithm by going to the emitter display tab, activate display constraints. Now you can see what is happening. There are small little connections between the particles. And this is what I'm going to use. So I want to have them growing the more distance they travel. This is pretty easy to do with the data mapping. So let's add the scale modifier again. Set this to particle radius. And again, to set a value. And I want to have it like 13. Now they're getting pretty big. And then I just add a mapping and change it to radius value again. And now I will use the distance travel. And the more they travel in 3D space, the larger they get. And now I have to just adjust the distance they are traveling. So this is 20 centimeters of traveling. And now when they just travel like 10 or 2 centimeters, they're getting larger. And this should be now visible. Like make it a little bit more faster. And now you see that they're growing, they're getting bigger. And I can just add, by pressing Control, I can just add a point on the sphere. And I want to have them bigger and then smaller again. Like this. And you see that this whole thing is triggered by this widget body collision. And now the XP constraints also has what I call a soft collision. And when I enable this, you can see that the particles are pushed. Let's decrease the particle amount a little bit. Like this. And now you see that the particles are getting like, are creating very nice wave particles. And the constraints are ripping off. That is really nice. And here are some examples I did with this technique. So you can also, with this technique, you can let, for example, you can grow ice crystals and grow cellular structures over here. Right, this mystique effect. All right. Constraint reactions. And the last but not least setup I want to show you is the self-spawning setup. And there's one feature in XParticles called XP spawn, and you can create a lot of particles out of one. And therefore, I'll just quickly go into my other scene. And here we have one particle. I just change this to one particle in shot emission. All right, it's not really visible. Let's change the display mode to circle. And I want to have a little bit bigger in the radius. All right, and let's make it a little bit smaller. All right, there we go. This is our source particle. And now I want to have like a spawn from it. And therefore, I can just add the modifier XP spawn. And the spawn modifier needs another particle emitter. So let's just add create emitter. And you can just drag and drop this emitter into the spawn. And now you see that a lot of particles are coming out of it. And I want to, let's first change, you can change the display of the spawn particles as well. All right. And now they're pretty fast and quite a lot. So let's change the spawning number to just one for now. And here it's the spawn number, either seconds or frames, and I want to have that frame-wise. Now, each frame a particle is spawned. And what I want to create is that they are spawning from themselves. And this is actually very high computative progress. And therefore, it is actually in there, but it's excluded right now. It's protecting your computer. So when I delete this spawn from the emitter, I have to quickly play stop, because because there are so many particles are generated from each other. Like, and this is what I want to control now. And this is easily done with the data mapping now. I can add a mapping. Then I set the spawning number. This is my parameter I want to change. And the spawning number I want to trigger when the particle traveled a certain distance. So when the particles are traveling more than 100 centimeters, like let's start with 50, they start to do a self-spawning. You see? It's a little bit more, it's a little bit less. And let's change this. All right, it's still too much. So I want to add a random attribute to this data mapping. I want to add a second data mapping. So let's change that mass. Use this attribute. You can use anything of that. But now I want to have like a value between 0 and 100. So I have this variation of 50. And now I can use this mass by adding another mapping. I want to affect the spawning number again. And I can use the mass attribute. And now I only want to have the particles spawning from themselves in a range from 0 to 1, just like in the lower range of that and the higher ranges of that. And now it should be less particles. Oh, this one, the first one needs a higher mass as well. All right, and now you see that our less particles are spawned from each other. And now I want to have them like more connected. And there I can use the XSPH fluid modifier, which creates fluid out of particles. And when I add that, simply add that, it's creating kind of a very natural looking connections between the particles. And this is going to, this is like creating real life in your computer. All right. So if you go further with this, you can do a lot of stuff with that. So for example, here I have a setup where I used only a few particles that are spawning trails and used a network modifier. And here you can see that they are somehow forming kind of an urban-looking city grid. Let's quickly check how that looks in Cycles4D. You can see them creating these. Or here I have an example. That is showing. Here are they are falling down. They should fall down. Nice. And now they like a cellular, like cells growing over. Oh, the camera is off. Right, there we are. All right, and here is another example. Like where you can create like growing plants out of particles with a self-spawning technique. Or here is something I've seen in Doctor Strange and I tried to rebuild it with this technique and it worked quite well. For example, this slow motion lightning. All right. So, and the last thing I want to show you is something that came up quite often and lately in motion design. It's like this particle-to-particle, like called particle circle packing. And therefore, I can use XP constraints as well, right? And let's quickly open the scene over here. And here I have my texture emission. And I want to have particles spawn only on certain places. So let's
go to my scene, I have some selections I can set in Cinema 4D. All right, and I can set selection over here. And I can use this selection in the XP emitter. And now the particles are spawning only at this place. Let's quickly just see them here. And now I want to like, they should collide now, and the XP constraints modifier that we used before has a very nice what I call soft collision. And let's add an XP constraints. Add in collision, activate the collision. Now they're pushing each other away. But I want to keep them together on the surface. And XParticles has a very nice follow surface modifier. And you can drag your sphere into the follow surface over here. And now the particles should follow. So it's a little bit wild. And we can increase the friction. So the particles are moving slower, pushing each other away. And here you have a little bit more options. So example, more the distance, and you can pull them more in onto the sphere. Let's add a little more friction. And now you can see that you can just add turbulence, for example, a turbulence over here. And this is pretty naturally looking now, and let's change to the cycles renderer. This is already set up. And I want to change to a certain focus. And you can see that the particles are pushing away, creating this pretty cool technique. All right, thank you very much. If you have any questions for XParticles, I'm here around the whole day from the booth. And yeah, we'll see us tomorrow. Thanks.